bulan Ramadan ini dengan penuh takwa dan tawaduk. Syukur Ramadan TV 2.
Thank you, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, for tuning in to Hello on 2 on your Monday afternoon. And of course, this is one of our darkest moments in history as we are all really, really sad for what have happened, the tragedy regarding MH17.
That's right. We have been, shocked with the news that we have received about MH370, which happened about more than 4 months ago. And we've been shocked again with another news last Thursday evening with the shooting down of the MH17, which happened in the Ukraine. Of course, a lot of things have been happening since then. We have been getting a lot of updates, especially when it comes to retrieving the bodies, right? And I think it's not still the full 298 yet. Yeah.
No, definitely not. And of course, in Kyiv, Malaysia is currently demanding immediate and unrestricted access to the Malaysia Airlines MH17 crash site and guaranteed safety for its officials and those of the Joint International Investigation Team. Transport Minister Datuk Sri Liao Tiong Lai said Malaysia also demanded that all human remains be allowed to be recovered, identified and repatriated. Mm-hmm. He said Kuala Lumpur was deeply concerned that the international team was effectively being prevented from entering the crash site. And of course, on top of that, Russian President Vladimir Putin has promised to cooperate with the outraged world leaders seeking access to the site of downed flight MH17 after Washington squarely pointed the finger of blame at Moscow for the crash. The under fire Russian leader appeared to seek to temper international fury after US Secretary of State John Kerry said the missile system used to shoot down the Malaysia jetliner was transferred from Russia in the hands of the separatists.
Yep. Mm. And we would like to show on the screen right now the names of the victims of passengers of MH17. And as you can see here on the screen, which we'll be showing really soon, these are the names that have been affected. And we also would like to wish our deepest condolences to the family members of the passengers. The US also has turned up the heat, especially in terms of asking Russia to give out more information, especially in terms of the black box, as well as giving more leeway to Russia to gain control, especially for Malaysians who would like to retrieve the bodies and possibly bring them back here in Malaysia. Those are the names. We have, I think, about 44 Malaysians altogether. 15 of them are the crew members. And we are deeply saddened by this incident.
That's right. We are at Hello and Two. Our heartfelt condolences and prayers to all the families and friends to the victims of the fallen MH17. And let's pray and continue to pray for a better light of justice and, of course, truth to appear anytime soon.
Yeah. And a group of concerned citizens backed by 80 non-governmental organizations will hold a sort of like a protest, apparently, in the city tomorrow for the innocent people on board of MH17, which was shot down in Ukraine last Thursday, calling the event MH17 Justice Gathering. The organizers actually urged all Malaysians to join in the protest tomorrow, which I think I don't know whether if it's really necessary to have such a protest.
Yes.
But yes, we also urge the people in Malaysia to consider this, especially because it's in the month of Ramadan.
Yeah. That's right. And without further ado, of course, we've got Shuhaida, who's our very new member of Hello on 2, who's going to be joining us right after this to give a live update from Rotterdam, Holland.
And with the correspondent, that, yeah?
Correspondent, yes. And before that, we're going to have a look at this MH17 clipping for your viewing.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Zamil and Sophia. And that was a little bit clipping about MH17. It is like the biggest incident that happened to Malaysia this year. So I'm pretty sure all of us who watched the clip just now can feel the sadness and the sorrow of the family members of the incident. So to know more about the family members, and I'm pretty sure all of us here are well informed of the condition of the family members here in Malaysia. But right now, on the line, we have Zahara Othman, an RTM correspondent in UK. However, she's right now at the Rotterdam Holland. Hello, Puan Zahara.
Hello.
Hello, Shada. Oh, what's up? Could you tell us a little bit about the family members at the Holland right now?
Okay, I came here about 2 days ago and met up with first friends of Allahyarham Muhammad Ali Mat Kalim. He was here as a student to study neuropsychopathology. And his friends actually took him to the airport to send him off. And that was the last time they saw him. And it was such a shock for all of them because the community, the members of the Malaysian Association of the Netherlands, they're very, very close. They're very close-knit society. And they were so shocked. And each of them had so much to say about Muhammad Ali, because he was just so much like a brother, like a son to everyone. And when I came here, they were all gathered here like the night before they sent him off. And they were still in shock and still trying to come to terms with what has happened, because he left his room as it was. It was as if he was coming back, you know. And that night they gathered and they had a tahlil session, and that was how they coped. And they were still talking about Muhammad Ali, what he used to do, what he did to them, how he helped them. And yesterday I went to see Kevin Lowe, who was the son of Jenny Lowe. Jenny Lowe and her husband, who was from Hong Kong, both of them and the mother, Jenny Lo's mother, came to visit Jenny and the mother from Penang. So the mother came to visit, and they were on the way back to take the mother home. So the three of them perished in this tragedy. So Jenny and her husband ran two Malaysian restaurants in Rotterdam, a very popular restaurant. And yesterday when I went to the restaurant to see, there were lots of flowers and lots of people who knew Jenny came, and they were all just standing around stunned, you know. And I spoke to Kevin, who at a very tender age, I mean, he's 30. He said goodbye to his parents, and this is it. Now he's got to run two restaurants, and he of course, he's still in shock. But he seemed to be able to, you know, to bear it and shoulder this responsibility now that his parents are gone.
All right, Puan. I understand the feelings that they're having right now. But could you tell us a little bit, is there any emotional cases that has been reported, especially for the family members from Netherlands?
Sorry, I can't hear that.
We understand all the sorrow and the sadness that they feel right now. But I would like to ask, is there any emotional cases that has been reported, especially to the family members in Netherlands?
Emotional status?
Yeah. For example, if they can.
Well, obviously, everyone is in shock, and especially there's a lot of anger about this. This blaming game, you know, who is to be blamed, who shot it down. But all they want now is they want answers, and they want the bodies back, you know. And while it is so far away, the crash site, and what you see on TV, what's unfolding on TV is quite, you know, it's not not a very nice visual image to see, and yet they feel so helpless. They can't get the body. They want to bury the body, so they are angry. And you can see that from the messages that is being left at certain sites where they've left flowers, you know, especially at Schiphol Airport. When I arrived on the first day, there were lots and lots of people just leaving flowers there and standing around in silence. And one or two messages left there, pointing and very, very angry at Putin, you know.
All right,
and
yesterday
I saw, yeah?
I understand that everybody's been waiting for the question mark that they have in their mind right now. But would you like? We're going to keep in touch with you soon because we're going to keep update our viewers with the family members in the Netherlands. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, so we just spoken a little bit with our RTM correspondent in UK about how do the family members in Netherlands handle their depressions, the feelings that they're having right now. But after this, we're going to speak to another Malaysian representative in France. If you're wondering what, why, who, and where is here right now, keep on tuning. We'll be back after this.
Saya, di hari yang mulia ini, ku pohon keampunan, hanya satu yang ku minta.
Hello on two, and today we're going to give you continuous highlight whenever we could regarding the tragedy of MH17. And now, of course, we want to get into our very first topic of the day.
That's right. The topic of the day is called a UN Chronicle, and this is based on the book that's been written by our guest in the studio, Tan Sri Razali Ismail, who is a former diplomat, right? Yeah.
Thank you so much for joining us today, Tan Sri. And maybe you can tell us a little bit more about this book right here.
Yeah.
Maybe we could start with an introduction to our viewers who are watching this.
Okay. This book is very late in production, so to speak. I retired over 15 years ago.
Yep.
It took me like 15 years to actually put it all down in writing. But I kept some notes of what I did. Almost daily notes.
Right.
What if you see on the here, here, behind here,
yeah,
are notes when that, I actually I put down when I was chairing the Security Council.
Right.
So I have a basis of recollecting what had taken place.
Right.
But the book is not an autobiography. It's not a memoir. It is called Chronicle deliberately because it fits into that classification where you talk a bit about yourself, but you also deal with the discussions about issues and all that.
Right.
And this book combines that.
And it spans 10 years or 11 years, 1988 till 1998, right?
Yeah. I was in the UN for 10 years, exactly 10 years, 88 to 98.
Right.
Okay. And on top of that, Tan Sri, there's a chapter on Palestine, and Malaysia has always been a staunch Palestine supporter. So the recent Israelis' campaign against Gaza claimed more than 190 lives and injured hundreds more. So being a former president of the United Nations General Assembly from the few years and the UN Secretary General Special Envoy to Myanmar, would you like to share with the viewers what the UN's role in ensuring peace, especially in the scenario that we are looking at currently in Palestine right now? Do you have any insights on that?
Well, obviously, we cannot allow, but we have been not been able to prevent it. That is, allow Israel to do what it wants to do, which is exactly what it has been doing all these years.
Right.
When, last 20 years. And that's only because Israel is supported by a very powerful friend, the United States, and has sympathy in virtually all the European countries. And also because the Arab countries and the other Muslim countries are weak in not being able to exert sufficient influence and pressure on these countries to do something about it. This creates a very dangerous situation where Palestinians get very desperate and very angry, and they want to go out there and do something. This is why you have the rockets going over to Israel, which is not very good for the Palestinians, because the retaliation from Israel is very big.
It is.
So it is very comprehensive. They are now invading on the ground.
That's right.
So, and there is not much that the Palestinians can do. I mean, I wonder whether the Palestinians will continue to struggle this way, even if they lose so many people. You know, they have lost maybe 400 people, and most of them are young people.
Yes.
The young people should be made to survive, to keep the struggle going, but not to to confront Israeli directly like this.
What are your thoughts on the things that should be done at this moment in time? Because our former Prime Minister Tun Dr. Mahathir has also criticised the OIC for, you know, keeping quiet about this, especially the Operation Protective Edge by Israel. What can be done?
I understand the frustrations of Dr. Mahathir. I, as a former diplomat, also get very angry, very frustrated. But I know that until and unless America commits totally towards making Israel behave and is prepared to put enough pressure on Israel to make it effective, it is not going to happen. There will be no change in this situation. The UN, as far as Israel and the Palestinian issue is concerned, is virtually helpless. And the performance of the UN before has been hopeless.
Mm-hmm.
The issues dealing with the Middle East have always been kept away from comprehensive consideration within the Security Council. This is an issue that certain major countries deal with outside the Security Council, outside the UN. So the Secretary General has very little power.
It also appears that the recalcitrant nature of Israel's peaceful ways are largely contributed by the lack of response from the Arabian League. And the rest of the world has reacted by condemning the public outcry to the extent of boycotting some businesses related to Israel. What's your opinion on this regarding the reaction of the people all over the world regarding boycotting brands by the country itself?
Israel. I mean, I can't understand where this anger is coming from for the people, ordinary people, including us all here in Malaysia. We are really very annoyed, very angry.
Indeed.
But anger and frustrations have their limits.
Correct.
They don't amount to making a difference on the ground.
Mm.
So if the Arabs and the rich countries want to do something about Israel, then they should apply economic and financial pressures to strangle Israel in that context.
Right.
And this no country has been able to do or has been willing to do.
Right. Okay. Back to your book, right? We actually wanted to ask earlier on what made you decide to publish this book in terms of, you know, chronicling your notes.
I am a very vain, conceited man in some ways. And I have always been impressed with people who can write.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I think in some ways I can write. But to write a book and make the book, to let the book be examined by the public, by critics, and that is opening yourself out as if you take off your clothes. You know? It can be a bad experience if you don't write the book properly.
Right.
I think I have done well enough in this book, which marries the personal experiences as well as the involvement of Malaysia, the country, on the issues at the UN.
What do you actually hope from from the readers? You know, what messages would you like to for the readers to take once they have read your book?
I am not that vain to think that there will be serious benefits for the people who read this book.
Okay.
I think it's an interesting account of what has happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's at a time when Malaysia was very active internationally.
Yes.
What you call international activism of Dr. Mahathir, translated to every embassy of Malaysia everywhere, and particularly in the UN, the international body. And at the time, the height of this, all doors opened for Malaysia in the UN. Every time there was a major issue in the UN, the UN will be among the first to be called for consultations. So having lived in that point at that time, so I thought we should record some of the things we were involved in.
Right. I'm sure many would appreciate looking at your views and perspective in your many years being together with the organisation. But of course, Tan Sri, if you don't mind, we'd like to ask some of your opinions regarding the tragic incident of the MH17, regarding the possible roles or actions that can be done by the United Nations in terms of seeking
handling.
Justice. Yes, especially many have questioned on why has the black box been placed in the hands of the Russians instead of a more
neutral
side who should be looking over this matter. Your opinion on this, Tan Sri?
My opinion is like everybody else. It's we are again put in a situation where after the earlier disappearance of our plane, MH370, we have now lost another plane.
Mm-hmm.
So the trauma is continued for all Malaysians.
Right.
But this time, a lot more non-Malaysians perished rather than us, although it's still our plane.
Yeah.
Again, the our country continues in the suffering, not having forgotten the other one.
Yeah.
So it is a terrible, terrible stroke of luck or whatever you want to call it.
Mm.
I don't believe in fatalism.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not a fatalist, but some people may believe that this is a very bad year for us.
Mm.
But dealing on the ground, you only have to deal with these separatists, people who want to break away from Ukraine,
mm-hmm.
who are armed to the teeth with very sophisticated weapons,
yes,
and who are in some ways not, there is no real central control on these people.
Mm.
This is why we have had this missile shooting down a Malaysian plane.
Yeah.
I don't think there was any plan to do this.
Yes.
But some idiot or some murderous guy
mm.
or some drunk person did this sort of thing. And we have to suffer from this situation. Basically, what you want to do is have the bodies back for Malaysia, for all the other countries,
mm-hmm.
To honor and to give dignity to those people that have died.
Mm-hmm.
This we must do. Then we must look at the black box, which must be given back to us because it is our plane.
Yes.
This one, you have to deal with the Russians.
Mm-hmm.
The Russians have the greatest influence on those people.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to depend on the friendship we have with Russia. This is not about confrontation.
Right.
This is not about banging tables.
Mm.
We have to get Russia to understand that they must help. It is a humanitarian thing that they have to do for us. So they must help to give us the black box, and they must help to make us understand what actually happened. We think we know what actually happened, but the world must be made to know this happened in the situation of serious turmoil and flux in the particular area, and it must never, never, ever happen again.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
And for us in Malaysia, it is a terrible double double blow.
Double whammy. Yeah.
Double whammy, yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And Tan Sri, I'm sure many would probably be questioning or having thoughts in your minds as well. What if we are able to find the culprit or the party who has done this to our very own people and the rest of other few nationalities on board MH17, what would be
the repercussions of it?
Yes, that's right. What will it face?
How will it affect Malaysians as well as the image of Malaysia?
Malaysia is a country that has undergone a lot of experiences, good as well as bad. We have helped the UN here and there. We were in the Congo. We were in Bosnia. We have an international track record.
Yes.
The country too has become savvy, sanguine, having experienced tragedies and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not a question of rushing to find somebody and hang him by the nearest tree. You cannot do it.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very unsettled situation.
It is.
We must demand the UN and the International Civil Aviation Organization to push for total understanding of what has happened.
Yeah.
And if there's a culprit to be found, he or that group will have to be accountable. But that, to me, about the culprit being brought to justice, is a long shot.
Right. Well, thank you so much for being here today, Tan Sri Razali Ismail, and of course for sharing with us regarding this chronicle, your efforts that you've been writing in, your thoughts and your experiences. Have a closer look, ladies and gentlemen. Maybe you could be sure to grab yourself a copy.
Yep. Do grab this book, UN Chronicles, 1988 to 98, the personal journey.
That's
of
right.
Our guest in studio, Tan Sri Razali Ismail. Thank you for sharing this with us and also your thoughts for the day. We wish you all the best. And for those viewers out there who would like to get a copy, do grab it at your nearest bookshop and bookstands. I'm sure they're available. And yes, we are now moving on to a special Skype session where we'd like to find out how Muslims, especially Malaysian Muslims, are celebrating Ramadan and the upcoming Hari Raya soon, which is happening just next week, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
A few more days to go.
Yep.
And of course, we're going to take a short little break before we pass it back to our lovely Shuhaida. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen.
See you soon.
Kopi style semudahnya berasid. Tapi, Kopiko LA Coffee memang sesuai untuk saya. Terutamanya, ketika bersahur. Ia satu-satunya kopi keluarga saya.
Aroma istimewa, rasanya pun enak.
Sesuai untuk kami dan ia halal.
Untuk berbuka puasa, Kopiko LA Coffee Ice memang sedap.
Saya pula suka Kopiko LA Coffee yang panas.
Selamat berbuka puasa bersama kopi yang sesuai dengan anda.
Isu pengguna terkini.
Solusi masalah anda.
Setiap Isnin, 9 malam.
Secara langsung di TV1. Suara kita,
hak kita.
The 7th World Summit on Media for the 21st Century Children from 8 till 10 September 2014 in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Let's make it happen. For more details, visit wsmc2014.org.
Semua barang kita dah ada kan?
Dah, semua dah ada.
Oi, tak sabar nak balik kampung kan?
Jom. Ya Allah bang, tak sabarnya nak balik kampung. Rindu sangat kat mak dengan abah. Rasanya jalan tak jam kan bang?
Lah, jalan kira pula kan? Tahun ni semua kita akan leping kan?
Mestilah, mesti seronok anak-anak. Ya Allah bang!
Apa dia?
Anak kita tertinggal! Macam mana ni?
Welcome back. If you're just tuning in, watching us, Zamil and Shuhaida at the moment, and we are having a very special Skype session with two of our Malaysian students, right?
Yep.
Who are now studying in I don't know how to pronounce it.
Toulon.
Yeah.
Toulon.
Okay. Yeah, I'm more familiar of Toulouse, but yeah, but Toulon is also in France. And we have Muhammad Haziq Arifin as well as Muhammad Amirul Amin Muhammad Zaid, who are both students of University of Toulon in France, and I believe they are joining us right now. Hello guys, good afternoon.
Hi boys.
Yeah, we understand it's 7 a.m.
Yep.
There, right? About 7 something in the morning.
It's quite early in the morning. Is it you having sahur over there?
Oh, of course. If not, it'll be very tiring.
Yes, we have to sahur. We have to.
What did you have for your sahur?
I cook Maggi, and eat.
And I just drink water.
I see.
Because I'm lazy.
Well, it's okay. Drinking water is good. Keeps yourself slim. Okay. It's about 7:30 there, right? If I'm not mistaken, in the morning?
Yes.
Yeah. And how do you usually spend your day? Especially if... I'm not sure. Is this your first time going through Ramadan in France for you guys?
Yes,
it is.
It's your first time.
It's your first time, right? How is the experience so far? How different is it from, experiencing Ramadan in Malaysia?
You mean in France?
It's very different. Even the duration of fasting here is different. It's 17 hours.
Oh.
And it is hotter.
Because now it's summertime.
Right.
And also... It's quite tiring because of the time, and we finish. Normally, we finish the Tarawih at 12 o'clock.
Oh.
And then we need to wake up again at 4 o'clock because we have the Subuh at 4:30.
Mm-hmm. So what about your sleeping time over there? You have fasting for 17 hours, right? And then what about your sleeping time and for the time for you to get back to have your sahur in your buka?
Your shorter sleeping time, sleeping hours.
Could you explain how you cooperate with that?
And normally we sleep just like 4 hours. Then we need to wake up again.
Yeah.
And of course we sleep at during the day.
Yeah. After we go back from class, we sleep to recover the sleep.
Because for this time, the night is too short. It's short.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, tell us, guys. Is there a sizable Muslim community aside from you guys, the Malaysian students? I'm sure you guys really you guys are really close knit. You would group up, right? What about the other Muslims in the community of Toulon? Is it quite sizable? Is it big?
There's a lot of Muslim here, especially the Arabs.
Yeah.
So when we go to mosque, there's a lot of Arabs there, and they are very kind to us. Sometimes they invite us to their house to drink tea or something.
Even though we are minority here, but they are very kind. They're very kind to us.
Okay.
So Haziq and Amirul, for the last question we're going to give to you guys here, can you please make a shout out to your family members or your friends, your relatives here in Malaysia?
Yep, Hari Raya is just around the corner.
Yep, 1 week away.
Okay, who first?
You.
Don't be shy, say it.
To all my friend and my family, I wish you all happy fasting and Selamat Hari Raya to everyone. I'm sorry I couldn't be there this Raya. I'm sorry.
And me, to all my family there in Malaysia, to all my teacher, to all my friend, I wish you all may this Ramadan will be a month full of forgiveness. Full of forgiveness. And even though I'm not there, I hope you guys have fun. And to all my friends, do your best in your study. Don't skip the process.
Okay, so we wish you guys all the best. Salam Ramadan, selamat berpuasa, as well as selamat Hari Raya. I'm sure this is a very wonderful experience for you guys, because it's the first time not only celebrating puasa but also Hari Raya away from your family and your loved ones here. So we wish you all the best and be safe and study hard. Yeah.
Yep.
Bonjour and au revoir.
Merci.
Okay. Thank you.
Allah.
See you again.
Bye.
All right. So that was Muhammad Haziq Arifin, as well as Muhammad Amirul Amin, Muhammad Zaid, both Malaysian students in University of Toulon in France. I tell you, the technology nowadays, it's so nice. If only I could do that Skype session with my family back then when I was studying in Australia. But anyway, so we wish them all the best, and also to all the other Malaysians who are living abroad, who are actually watching us on rtm.gov.my. We wish you all the best and Selamat Hari Raya in advance. We are going to take a short break, right?
Yep, we're going to take a short break, and we're going to continue with another interesting session with the Israeli violation against the Palestinians. So if you want to know more about it, keep on tuning. We'll be back.
Welcome back. If you're just tuning in, you're watching us, Sophia and Zamil, on this Monday afternoon. And yes, aside from the disturbing news that we have received regarding MH17, yes, we are also being disturbed with another also bigger news, which would concern all Muslims around the world.
That's right. Especially in the holy month of Ramadan, this has been very disturbing for not just Muslims, but many out there who are supporters of the of creating a better peace in the land of Palestine. And now we're going to get more information and highlight from someone who has lived and grew up in the Gaza Strip almost a lot of years of his life, and he's right here with us to highlight on the topic, the Israeli violations against the Palestinian. Thank you so much for joining us today, Mr. Tamir Al-Kadash.
Thank you so much for hosting me.
Thank you. And of course, he is a volunteer of the PGPF and an international peace activist.
That's right. Just for information, guys, the PGPF is Perdana Global Peace Foundation.
That's right.
Maybe, you know, for the benefit of the viewers, right, yes, Tamir, maybe you can tell us what is PGPF all about, the foundation?
Yeah, it's Perdana, it's called Perdana Global Peace Foundation. It's to share the peace the whole around the world.
Yes.
They carried the peace message to make sure there's no more miskill anywhere. They need to share the peace to everywhere, anywhere, for everyone.
Right. Now, Tamir, regarding to your experience living most of your life there in the Gaza Strip, tell us more about how is the living condition there like, some of the general information, the capacity, the population. How is it actually having your life there?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for hosting me in this show. And special thank for Britannic Global Peace Foundation to give me a chance to speak up about Gaza. So, speaking about Gaza, actually, I will speak about the population in Gaza. The population in Gaza, there are more than 1.8 million people. They stay at Gaza with 365 kilometers.
Right.
Square kilometers, they only allowed to move in 41 kilometers for length, 41, imagine, and from 6 to 12 kilometer as a width. So if you try to move or skip this limit, the Israeli soldiers will shoot you down. This is from the ground. Forgot to seashore. Also, you have only 6 kilometers for fishing. So yeah, it's short actually, but all the fish it's after 6 kilometers. So even you for fishermen cannot fish anymore. If you try also to move more than 6 kilometers, the Israel will shoot you down again. The terminals, actually we have one terminals with the Egyptians. It's using for travel. Most of this time, actually, it's closed. And we have three terminals with Israelis. Also, it's two of them, it's used for products.
Okay.
They just open it when they need to get their own benefit, you know?
When they feel like it.
Yeah. And the third one, it's using for the journalists and international, the non-Palestinian, let me say, they took him as a solidarity with Palestinians because sometimes they cannot use the Egyptian terminal.
Right.
Yeah. So it's look like actually a big jail, the biggest jail in the whole world, Gaza now.
It is.
Yeah. The non-Palestinian also used to come as a witnesses to see the violation against the Palestinian. And some of them, they get killed. Some of them, they get injured. Such as, we have an example actually, Rachel Corrie, she's an example.
So who is Rachel Corrie? Maybe you can give us a little bit highlight or some information as the media from all over the world is raving on this particular person. Tell us more about Rachel Corrie.
Yeah, Rachel Corrie, she is one of an international peace activist. Mm. She came to Gaza mm-hmm. to defend, actually.
Right.
She is a witness for the violation.
Okay.
She came in 2003 with a member called Brubel Stein for International Solidarity Movement.
Okay.
She get killed after 2 months, mm-hmm. actually, when she arrived to Gaza. She get killed in Rafah State in Gaza Strip, which is in South Gaza.
That is extremely disturbing, being a person who is an actual peace activist. Yeah. But how mm-hmm. how did she get assassinated and yeah. why?
Mm. How she get assassinated? Mm. Uh-huh. Okay, actually, she came as a volunteer.
Okay.
To share the truth yeah. for the violation against Palestinians.
Yes.
She used to come to the borders day after day to stop the bulldozers, mm. demolish more houses and stop tank shoot more people. So actually, for Palestinians, she is a hero. Mm. Yeah, because she used to, during 16th of March 2003, mm-hmm. Quraysh get killed. Because after 3 hours defend in front of the bulldozers, she was wearing a safety jacket and she was holding a speakers to speak up to the bulldozer drivers before he ran over of her. Mm. Yeah. She was telling him, you need to stop this, you need to stop demolish, you need to stop to destroy more house.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Then after 3 hours, the bulldozer driver, he get orders to finish this target, which is Richard Khoury. Right. The bulldozer, he ran over here, and mm-hmm. he demolished after this the right. the house, the full house. Mm-hmm. The Israelis, they only call for the human rights, but they did not apply for themselves. Rachel Khoury, she is not the only one.
Yeah.
There are so many. Last one, it was before 2 weeks ago, mm. which is a kid. The Israelis punish him hardly. He's an American.
Mm.
Yeah, punish him hardly because he was also defense on his cousin. They burn him alive.
Yeah.
Yeah. They killed him.
There were videos caught on camera and over a few media titles all over the world on how he was treated by the military, the American boy, and it was really devastating.
Yeah. Mm. Mm. So because of what happened to Rachel Khoury, right?
Yeah. Mm.
So that's how the Perdana Global Peace Foundation also started. Is that true? Is that
yeah.
correct? Yeah. What has been done so far?
Yeah. Mm. 2011,
yeah.
Perdana Global Peace Foundation, they decide and managed to break the siege on Gaza by sending infrastructure supplies to Gaza after get destroyed by Israeli violation. So they send actually a ship to the Palestine in the spirit of Rachel Khoury.
Mm.
It counted by 4.5 kilometers long mm. for swerage system.
Mm.
And it's alhamdulillah successfully go through Gaza and this get assistance by government, Egyptian government. They give full support to let this ship actually enter Gaza.
I see.
You actually mentioned earlier that Gaza is like the biggest jail
yes,
in
sir.
The world right now. I think a lot of us are also wondering, how do you actually earn a living? In terms of working, earning money and all that, supplies and all that, how difficult is it to actually... some people would actually say lead a normal life in terms of, you know, you waking up in the morning, you like to go to work, and then at the end of the day you like to earn money and get some income. With all these things that are happening, how is it being done over there right now?
it's really tough, you know. It's really hard to the people, but the people, they need to adapt with this environment. Especially when you wake up sometimes, you did not find electricity, there's no water, so you cannot take shower, let me say. That you need to adapt with this environment. The people, they need to work. They work, actually.
Yeah.
They have money, but we don't have products to buy.
Right.
Yeah.
Even have.
Yeah, there's no products, actually. You cannot even build any new houses.
Oh.
Yeah. So everybody, he tried to adapt with this environment. Actually, we need a normal life, such as 24-hour electricity.
Yes. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Airport to travel.
Yes.
Yeah. So we wish one day we're gonna get independent state of Gaza.
And at the moment where the places that Israel has attacked, is it scattered or is it just one place that's concentrated? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is it like the whole of Gaza that's been affected or is it just one part?
Yeah, actually last update until last night.
Yeah.
There are more than 350 Palestinians killed. They are civilians. More than 150 killed. They are kids. 30 women and 15 old men. Last night, more than 60 people they killed. They mass kill in Al Shajaiya area. You can find the bodies to the whole, all the streets. Even the ambulance was attacked. So all the targets now, it's like random targets.
Yes.
The kids are the targets, you know. The whole Gaza is still under attack now. No one can survive. Mm-hmm. They will kill you. They will kill you with your whole family. The whole family is actually, they killed during they take Barbuka Bouassa, you know. You can see the pictures around the world.
Now, Tommy, unfortunately, we do not have enough time to put more light onto this, but we truly do feel the pain and the sufferings of the people, especially in the Gaza Strip. And let's all keep praying for the best and to provide as much assistance as we could in terms of prayers and, of course, our financial backing. Thank you so much, Tamir Kadas, for coming with us today. I'm sure this will give a better light and, of course, understanding to fellow Malaysians who are watching this.
That's right.
Now, we have, of course, a giveaway for you to have a look at, in which we're going to ask two questions for you to be allowed or to bring back prizes exclusively from Starbucks, in which we will be highlighting onto Facebook as well. Just make sure you need to just drop us a message onto our Hello On 2 page. And now the questions there too would be one of them.
Yep. Well, we have one question. Which, we have two questions, right?
That is right.
The first question will be, who is our new host for today?
Yes.
If you remember her name. She has been appearing in our show, I think a better half of the better part of our show this today, and also a few shows on Hello On 2.
Yes.
What is her name? And at the same time, the second question is...
And the second question is, give us two titles of the segments that's been highlighted on today's session of Hello On 2. So just give us these two answers. What's the name of the new host on board today? And of course, the two titles of the segments that's highlighted on to Hello On 2 today.
Yep. All you have to do is log on to facebook.com slash Hello On 2 and also send us a private message so that we can track down who are the people who answered the questions correctly.
Yep.
And you stand a chance to win some vouchers from us.
That's right. So you will win 10 free drinks from Starbucks worth 150 ringgit. So take this opportunity to try out Starbucks' new summer beverage, Strawberry. So it's available at all outlets. And thank you so much for joining us today. I'm sure it's a very, very difficult moment for all of us here in Malaysia. Right. But please stay strong, keep praying, and let's wish for the best.
Yep. Zamil, Sofia and Shuhaida signing off for the day, and we wish you all the best, and we hope to see you same time, same place tomorrow, inshallah. Take care, everyone. See you soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye. مالك يوم الدين
نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم.